So, welcome back. This is the second last lesson of algorithmic design. Please let me know if you are there by sending an acknowledgement on the chat. During the last lesson, we introduced the problem of during the last lesson, I introduced the problem of string matching, pattern matching, which is the problem of establishing all the value shift for a pattern on a text. So we want to find all the occurrence of the pattern in the text itself. And we saw the naive solution, which takes time big O of length of the pattern multiplied by the length of the text. And we start investigating a new idea, the idea of using a prefix function, which basically for every prefix of the pattern to give you the length of the longest prefix of that pattern, which is also suffix for it. And this may be a crucial idea to discover a better algorithm than the naive one. During the last lesson, we were discussing about let me see. Here we are. So during the last lesson, we were discussing about the property of the prefix function, which we called pi, and we saw that the set of all the iteration of pi from q, which we called pi star q, has in particular this property. So if pi q is greater than 0, then pi q minus 1 belongs to pi star q minus 1. This property basically gives us the chance of evaluating pi q by starting from pi star q minus 1. So if I have the sequence of the largest prefix for the sequence of the prefixes, which are also suffixes for the prefix p q minus 1, I can get somehow the prefix of the prefix which is the largest prefix, which is also a suffix for pq, and this is basically indicated by this lemma. So starting from this lemma, since we want to get the largest prefix of pq, which is also a suffix for it, we may go through all the set of the all the set of p star pi star, sorry, for q minus 1, and get the largest prefix which is extendable, which is defined by this set, okay? And by using this set, we can recursively define pi q in this way. So pi q would be 0 if of course the set of the prefixes for pq minus 1, which are also suffixes, proper prefixes of pq minus 1, which are also suffixes for it, are empty. Okay, otherwise we are searching for the largest value of pq minus 1, which is extendable by one character. In that case, we increase that value by one. Now, let's have a look at the code just to un better understand what's going on. And this is the code to compute the prefix function for the prefix p, for the pattern p. So first of all, we need to initialize the array pi, giving to it the same size of the prefix itself, of course. So the first element in the prefix in the pi array should be set to 0. Why? Because we are searching the proper prefix of P1, which is also a suffix for it. But of course, the proper prefix of P1, which contains exclusively one character, would be the empty string. And so here we need to place 0, meaning that the length of the proper prefix of P1 is, of course, 0. Then we start from a given k, so the given k is 0, so we start basically from the same value of pi 1, and going through all the character in the pattern, we try to extend the value of p q minus 1. So while this is basically the length of the largest prefix, which is also a suffix for proper prefix, which is also a suffix for q, which are considered a certain point. So we are going through we are considering the prefix of length k at this point, and we want to test whether the next character in the prefix of length k is equal to pq, which is the next character in the pattern we want to extend. So if this is not the case, we need to decrease the pattern we are considering, and to decrease it we need basically to apply the pi array once, and we keep applying the pi array once, so going through all the value in pi star basically, until either the prefix we are considering is empty, or we end up in a situation in which the next character of the prefix we are considering match the character we want to extend in the pattern we are considering right now, in the prefix of the pattern we are considering right now. So if after this while loop this condition holds, so we are able to match the next character in the prefix pk with the last character of the prefix pq, then we can increase by 1 the length of the prefix we are considering as a proper prefix of pq, which is also suffix for it, okay, because of course that would be pk plus 1. So if this condition holds, the largest proper prefix of pq, which is also suffix for it, of course will be pk plus 1. If this doesn't hold, of course it would be pk, and that's all. So once we increase by 1, possibly increase by 1 k, we assign as I said, 2 pi q. So here we need to store the largest proper prefix of pq, which is also suffix for it. We store k. Okay. And please notice that this condition does not hold exclusively when k is equal to 0. So as soon as this while loop ends, either this condition holds or this condition holds. Well, both of these conditions must hold. So either we conclude the execution of the code because k is equal to 0, or we conclude the execution of this while loop because this condition holds. Okay? So the only chance to have do not execute this code is because k is equal to 0 and this condition doesn't hold. Great. Now let's have a look at a possible working example, just to better understand what's going on here. So at the beginning of the for loop iteration, we have that k is equal to pi q minus 1. Okay. So During the initialization, we set this value to 0. Then we start iterating the for loop from q equal to 2. So q equal to 2 corresponds to this charter, of course. Okay, and since this was set to 0, k is equal to 0, so here I'm reporting a pointer to k plus 1. Okay, now we said that this is the largest proper prefix of pq minus 1, so for 1, which is also a prefix for pq minus 1. So this is the initialization, and this is what you have seen. Then no while loop iteration occur, simply because we cannot match any value here, but k is equal to 0. Okay. So since k is equal to 0, no while loop occurs. So we now are in the if condition, and we need to test whether this value match this one, but this is not the case. So we can assign to pi 1 again the value 0, because the largest prefix of this prefix of p2, which is ab, the largest prefix proper prefix of p2, which is also suffix for it, is the empty string. So we can assign here 0, and this is it. Let's move to the next character. Now, at the beginning of the iteration here, we have q equal to 3, of course. K is again 0, because it's the longest prefix, proper prefix, which is also suffix for p2. Okay, and here. We are the while loop condition test whether this character, which is pq, is equal to this character, which is pk plus 1. And this is the case. So at this point, we may end up the while loop. And the if condition, of course, is true. So we increase by 1 k. And by increasing by 1 k, we also can assign k to this value, saying that the prefix of length 3 of p as proper prefix of it the string a, proper prefix which is also suffix for it, the string a. Okay, so the longest proper prefix of p3, which is also suffix for it, is p1, and here we have. Okay, and so here again we repeat the for loop. Now on the fourth step of for loop, third step of for loop, we are dealing with q equal to 4, k is equal to 1, because we increase it during the last step, and again the while loop never being executed. So we don't need to perform any iteration, block iteration of the while loop, simply because pq is equal to pk plus 1. Okay, so on this condition, we know that the longest proper prefix of p4, which is also suffix for it, is p2. Okay. As a matter of fact, here at the beginning of P4 we have AB, at the end of P4 we have AB. So again, the if condition holds, so we increase by 1k. And of course, we assign to pi 4 with sign 2. And this is the case. Now, the last iteration of the while loop, sorry, of the for loop deals with q equal to 2. k is equal to 2, sorry, q equal to 5, k is equal to 2 because we increase it during the last step, last iteration of the for loop. And so let's have a look at the condition of the while loop. Well, in the condition of the while loop, we have that the next character, so the character we are dealing with is different from the next character with respect to the previous pi prefix, okay? So the next character of pi q minus 1 is different, which is k plus 1, is different from pq. So because of that, we need to apply to iterate the while loop once, and we need to apply the pi function, which basically revert this k to revert this k to zero. Okay, because this is k plus one, so this is k, and pi k bring us to zero, and so. And so after the second iteration of the while loop, so the second iteration of the while loop does not occur, and then we can assign zero to this element of the pi function. So in this way we are able basically of the pi array to compute the prefix function, and which is basically by iteratively increasing the possible prefix function. Okay, so we keep increase the value until we end up in a situation in which we don't get a match. We keep repeating the iteration of the pi of the prefix function until we end up either in zero or in a situation in which we can extend it. Now. Let's have a look at the code. This is the code, and let's try to compute the complexity of this code. Okay, so here we have a for loop and a nested while loop. So how can we compute the complexity of it? Of course, the initialization of the compute prefix function takes time. Theta 1, so it's constant. What about the remaining part of the code? Well, at each iteration of the for loop, we may increase k at most by 1. Okay? So every time we repeat the for loop, it could be the case that we increase k by 1 or it remains the same value. While at each iteration of the while loop, since this pi represents a prefix function, which is a function from a length to a shorter length, because we want to get the length of the proper prefix of pk. So this prefix function is decreasing for sure. So every iteration while loop brings k from a value to a value which is smaller to him. Okay. Now, so for every iteration of the for loop, we can increase k by 1, at most by 1. For every iteration of the while loop, for sure we are decreasing k of at least 1. So the overall number of time we are repeating this for loop, this while loop, sorry, is at most upper bounded by the number of time we repeated this for loop. So cumulatively, this while loop can be executed at most the very same time we perform this increase. So since k at most can be equivalent to the length of p, this while loop can be executed at most a number of times globally on overall the computation, so not for a single for loop, but overall the computation can be executed at most length of p times. Okay? So this means that the complexity of this executing this specific function is linear with respect to the length of p, so is big O of length of p. Let me repeat. So here we are seeing a for loop and a nested while loop. However, at each iteration of the for loop, we are increasing k at most by 1. Okay? While at each iteration of the while loop, which is nested in for loop, for sure we are decreasing k of at least 1. Since the god of the while loop is k greater than 0, the number of times we are repeating this while loop cumulatively, so all over during all over the computation of a compute prefix function, is at most equivalent to the number of times we are increasing k by 1. So the number of times we are repeating this for loop. So the overall complexity of this function is big O of length of p. I hope this is clear. And of course, since of course we are going through all the p, is theta of p actually. Okay. Now, this is just to compute the prefix function, but how can we use it to get all the possible value shift for p on the text? Well, the idea is the idea proposed by Knut Morris-Pratt algorithm, which is basically the algorithm the guys who proposed the prefix function as a good idea for the string matching problem. So the idea is to use the prefix function to try to fix mismatch. So once a mismatch has been identified, trying to matching the pattern on the text, we apply the prefix function, and we keep applying it until we end up in a situation in which that specific character we are considering in the text can be matched. Okay, and if it is not possible, of course we skip that character and say, okay, that character does not belong to any valid shift. Let's see the code, which is really, really similar to the code we saw for the for computing the prefix function. As a matter of fact, here we have a for loop, as you see. Here we have a while loop, which is almost identical to the one we saw on the prefix function. And the idea is basically very the same. So we keep considering where. So q is the length of the prefix we have matched on the text. So at the beginning will be 0, of course. We are considering the character I on the text. And while the prefix we are considering is greater than 0, and we can match the next character on the prefix and we cannot match the next character of the prefix with the character we are dealing with on the text, we keep applying the prefix function, okay? And at the end of this while loop, if the next character on the prefix we are dealing with can be matched with the character we are dealing with on the text, well, we increase by 1 the prefix we are matched. Until what? Until we end up in a situation in which the prefix we have been able to match is as length equal to the length of p. So if the prefix we have matched on the text is as the length of p, of course we discover the value shift, and we may add that value shift to the list of value shift for the prefix on the text, and this is done by this stuff. Then, after that, of course, we need to go on and try to find another valid shift, and to do it again we use the prefix function. Okay, and this prefix function basically bring us to the larger proper prefix of p, which is also suffix for it, and we keep repeating until the end of the text. Now, this is almost all. So now let's try to figure out the complexity of this stuff. So to compute the prefix function, we need to spend a time which is theta of length of p. Again, as we saw in the previous case, q can be increased exclusively here, and it can be increased at most by one at each iteration of the for loop, while the inside the while loop we have an instruction which is decreasing the value of q of at least one. And since the guard of a while loop is q greater than zero, it turns out that cumulatively the number of time we are repeating the while loop is at most the number of time we repeated the for loop. So again, here this while loop can be performed at most length of t time along over the computation. So the complexity of this for loop for sure is, well, of course this append takes time constant in time. So the complexity of this for loop takes time theta of length of t. Okay, because this while loop can be executed at most the number of time which is equivalent to the number of time we increase q. Of course. So the overall complexity of this algorithm, which is the Knuth-Morris-Pratt algorithm, is theta of length of p plus length of t. So it's linear in the sum of the two lengths, which is a really good improvement with respect to the previous situation. Okay? Here we can find an execution of the Knuth-Morris-Pratt algorithm, which is really straightforward. I mean, once you understand how the prefix function has been computed, this is the test, this is the pattern we want to match on the text, and this is the prefix function as we computed on the previous example. So we start from q equal to zero. So as usual, here I draw a pointer to q plus one because it's easier, I mean, to follow what's going on. Here we have matching. So since we have matching, so I of course start from one. Here we have a matching. So since we have a matching, the while loop never occurs. So the block corresponding to the while loop in the first iteration of the for loop is not executed, of course. And since we have a match, we can increase q by one, and this is the situation at the beginning of the second iteration of the of the for loop, sorry. So again, here we have a match. So the block corresponding to while loop is not executed during the second iteration of the for loop. And again, we have a match, so we increase q by one. Third iteration of the for loop, again, we have a match. Fourth iteration of the for loop, again, we have a match. Fifth iteration of the for loop is much more interesting because here we have a mismatch. So since we have a mismatch, we need to iterate inside the while loop. And we need to apply the prefix function. The prefix function for q equal to 2 tell us that we need to match this. We need to try to match this character with the character next to the following the prefix on left 2. So from this situation, by applying one iteration of the for loop, we end up in this situation. So this is the situation, and we need, right now we are trying to, so after one iteration of the while loop, we are trying to match this character with this character. So since they match, of course we can increase by one q, and we end up with this situation, okay? And this is the fourth iteration of the while loop, of course. Sorry, the sixth iteration of the for loop, and here we have a match. So again, the while loop is not needed, is not executed. Another iteration for loop. Again, we have a match. This match tells us that we basically are being able to discover all the pattern on the text. So we need to include this the sheet corresponding to this matching. So which is the position I minus the length of p plus one. And this is the valid shift we discover. Once we discover it, we need to apply the prefix function, which tell us that there's no way to shift p and match this character c. So we need to again start from the beginning. Okay. So this is a valid shift, and during the next iteration we end up in this situation. And this is it. Okay, so this is the complexity, we already saw it, nothing special. So just have a look at the example and try to understand what's going on. Now, we have another algorithm which is really intriguing because, for string matching, which is really intriguing because it's sublinear. But let me have a look, really quite quick look on it, because I don't want to spend too much time on it. This algorithm is based on basically a strange idea. Instead of trying to match the pattern on the text moving from the right, from the left of the pattern to the right of the pattern, we try to discover by shift by doing the opposite. So we are moving from the right to the left, which is strange from our point of view, because we are used to read the we are used to read the string from the left to the right. So you may wonder why we are doing this operation. You will see why we choose to move from, but better, why Boyer, Moore and Galil decided to move from the right to the left, and you will see it in a while. So this algorithm is based on three main ingredients, which are a good suffix rule, bad character rule, and what is called Galil rule. Okay, let's have a look at all these rules in the row and try to understand what's going on. So the good suffix rule tell us that once we have matched the last, let's say, n character here, and we discover a mismatch, we need to shift the pattern on the right, discovering the rightmost occurrence of the suffix we have already matched, whose following character is different from the one we weren't able to match. Okay. So the idea is, in this specific case, we are trying to find the rightmost occurrence of AB in the pattern, and whose next character is different from B. And in this case, of course, the rightmost occurrence of AB in the pattern is this one, of course, avoiding this occurrence. So is this one, and of course the next character, their next character C, is different from B. So from this situation, once I've discovered a mismatch, I can go here. Okay. And what if there is no of such pattern inside the pattern P? So what if there is no rightmost occurrence of AB in P whose next character is different from B? Well, in that case, so let me slightly change the pattern just to let you know what's going on here. As you see, I change a C into B. So here we have AB, again AB as before, but the next character is B as we have here. So there's no way to move on the right and finding a different situation with respect to the one we have already tested. So the right thing to do is to completely shift the pattern outside the mismatch we already discovered here. Okay, now how can we compute the good suffix rule? Well, the good suffix rule is almost like an inverse prefix function. So if you revert P, you end up in understanding more or less which is the same. So we are finding a prefix, so reverse P, and you discover that the prefix of the reverse P, we are finding the largest prefix of the reverse P, which is also suffix for it, and this is the reverse of the good suffix rule. So basically we already know how to compute it. Okay, so the complexity of computing the good suffix rule is theta of length of P, because we already know how to compute the prefix function. Okay, so before moving to the next rule, let me answer one question. I've just received on the chat. I have a couple of questions. We are long text stored like a one-dimensional array or like a matrix. We have a text represented as one dimensional array. I mean, there's no difference between one dimensional array and one dimensional matrix. Is there a difference? I don't think so. However, I mean, if you think of the implementation of the string in C, in the C programming language, you end up in understanding that it's just like an array of character. And how this algorithm works in case of pieces of text split in special character new line. Well, this algorithm, so all the algorithm we saw until now deal with the new line just like a normal character. So if in your pattern you have a new line, you can discover new line. Otherwise, I mean, in your pattern you may have or not have the new line. If you are searching for the new line, for instance, you will have the new line character inside your pattern, otherwise you don't have it. Okay, so this is to answer two of the questions I just received. This is the good suffix rule. Let me move on to the bad character rule, and this is why this rule is really important, because it let you understand why we decided to move from the right to the left. So let's consider the case in which at some point of your matching you discover a character, you discover a mismatch. Okay, and this mismatch is a mismatch in which the text, the character of the text tells you something about how to move the pattern. Okay? Why? Because here we have a C. We have a C. And since the rightmost occurrence of the C in the pattern is this one, for sure to match this character with this one, we can shift all the pattern by two character forward. Okay? So the idea is to match, to try to match the character we mismatch on the text with the rightmost occurrence of that character on the pattern. In this way. Okay? And please notice that by doing this, we avoid basically we avoid to test this value, so this character. Okay, so this character has never been considered to perform this operation. But what if it doesn't exist, that character? So what if this character C is not present in the pattern? Well, in that case, I can simply move on, move forward, and skip that character. So now let's consider the case in which our text is consists in a lot of characters which are not present in the pattern. So I can move on. So since all the characters in the text are not present in the pattern, at each iteration of my try. So every time I try to match one character, I can move forward the character by the long. Sorry, I can move forward the pattern by switching by length of p characters. So I'm skipping basically all the characters in the middle. Okay, so instead of matching all the characters in the text, I'm matching exclusively length of t divided by p characters. And since I'm discovering the mismatch, I can basically move on by length of p character. Okay. And because of that, in this lucky situation, we are able to perform a string matching, to solve the string matching problem by using this bad character rule in a sublinear way with respect to the length of t. Because we can skip a lot of character of the text. So let's try to discover how we can compute the bad character rule. The idea is to initialize an array C. The length of the array, of course, will be equivalent to the length of the alpha that we are dealing with. At the beginning of computation, we need to assign to each element in the array C the length of P, meaning since we haven't already discovered that character inside our pattern, the shift due to the bad character rule should be the all pattern C. Okay. Now, going through all the character in the pattern, I can update the shift required to reach that character once we discover a mismatch. And so the overall complexity of this procedure, at the end, of course, of this for loop, I end up with an array which basically encode the bad character rule. So the overall complexity of this procedure is theta of length of p plus length of the alphabet, cardinality of the alphabet. Okay, why? Because this process, the first two steps takes time theta of cardinality of the alphabet, while the last step take time length of p. And finally, this is the Galileo rule, which tell you how to behave when you have discovered a valid match. So once you have discovered a valid match, so a valid shift, I mean, if the pattern is periodic, meaning you there is a pattern which is repeated inside the pattern itself, and the repeated pattern is as length k, such in this case, then you can simply, once you have discovered a valid shift, you can shift the pattern forward by k value, where k is the period of the pattern p. Okay, and this way we can avoid all the matches to repeat all the matches which correspond to the length of p minus the period. And these are basically all these matches can be get by free. Now, so the overall Bowyer-Moore-Galilei algorithm performed the following way. So we try to match p on t backward. Okay, if we get a mismatch, then we select the largest shift among the rules suggested by the good suffix and bad character rules. So we consider the good suffix and the bad character rule. These two rules suggest two different shifts, and we take the largest among the two. If a valid shift is found, we try to apply the Galileo rule. Okay. And that's all. So what's the complexity of this algorithm? The complexity of this algorithm is big O of length of p plus length of t. Please notice, I mean, this is not theta. And the reason it's not theta is because if we have many, many mismatch, and the bad character rule suggests to skip all the pattern, you end up in having a sublinear scenario with respect to t. Okay, which is nice. So this algorithm is the algorithm which is implemented into I don't know, Word or LibreOffice and stuff like that. So once you have a text which change quite openly, and when you want to find a small pattern inside the test, this is the algorithm you have to look at. Okay? Nice. So let's move to a different topic, the very last topic of this course, which is, however, still related to string matching problem, to the pattern matching problem, which is the multiple pattern string matching problem. So let me quickly introduce it. So as you probably know, every living being has something called DNA. So the DNA is a way in which lives is encoded inside our cells, and basically is used to differentiate living beings and so on and so forth. So why is it interesting to study DNA? Well, studying DNA is interesting to forecast disease, to treat genetic condition, and so on and so forth. So to perform this stuff, of course, we need to read DNA, and to read DNA, we can use what is called sequencer, which are machine devoted to reading DNA. Unfortunately, these machines cannot yet accurately read a single DNA molecule. So a DNA molecule, for instance, for human being, a DNA The set of overall DNA molecules account 3 billion base. So all the human beings are equipped with a string whose length is 3 billion arter, different arter. The longer is the unfortunately, the longer is the reading, the higher is the probability of error in a sequential. So you cannot read the full sequence of DNA of a human being in a straight way, straightforward way. So the idea is to take many repetitions of the same sequence to break up them in short species. And then to read these species. And once you have all these billion of million of sequence of or billion better of fragments, you need to perform something called assembly, which is like a 1D, one-dimensional puzzle. You have to rebuild the original sequence by overlapping all these species. Okay? Now, this operation is slow, expensive, and takes much time. There might be many errors, and so on and so forth. So we want to avoid to perform all this operation for any individual we want to study. So the idea is to have a reference genome, which is something built up in this way. So we perform once for all this operation, and once we have performed once for all this operation, we can try to again take multiple repetition of the DNA of a specific DNA of the specific individual, and again break all these instances of DNA in small pieces, and read them by using sequential, and then once we have all these sequence, small sequence, we want to align them over the reference genome to discover the differences and understand what's the difference between a man having blue eyes, a man having green eyes, a man having a tumor, a man not having a tumor, and so on and so forth. Okay? So the idea is to have a quite large text and to try to match many different patterns on this text. Okay? So the problem is, as I already said, we have a text, huge text. It could be up to, let's say, 20, I mean, probably the crop has a DNA having length 25 billions nucleotide, so is a text consisting in 25 billion characters, and we want to find all the possible occurrence of many different patterns, billions of patterns. Of course, a possible solution would be to use the Boyer-Moore-Galil algorithm, for instance. In that case, the complexity will be big O of length of the text multiplied by the sum of all the patterns we are dealing with. Why? Because for each pattern, we are, well, this is. Let me think. Oh yes, because for each pattern we need to consider for each pattern we need to consider cardinality of T. Okay? So this would be really too much, I mean, to be considered. Oh no, this probably should be L. So this is big O of length of t multiply L plus this sum. Okay? So this is, however, too much to be taken into account. So we need to find a different way to perform this multiple pattern string matching problem. So a way in which basically, different from what we did until now, instead of considering one single pattern, pre-processing the pattern and trying to match the pattern on the text, in this case, could be useful to pre-process the text, build up a data structure in which finding the pattern without any pre-processing is easy, and then try to pattern matching the pattern on the new data structure we build out from the text. So a possible solution would be a solution based on tree, for instance. So the idea could be to have starting from a text to build up a tree in which we represent all the possible substring of t. So in this case, for instance, we are representing let me answer one question. The idea to find the text that can be correct arrangement of all the patterns, or knowing that the position of each pattern is enough. So if you are talking about the assembly problem, well, of course, to know the correct position of the pattern, you need to. So if you want to start from the scratch and take all the pieces of DNA you have just built and you have just read, and you want to rebuild the overall DNA, of course you need to add two overlaps. Otherwise, how you know which pieces goes first and goes after? Okay, so that's why I said that you need to solve a huge 1D one-dimensional puzzle. And as far as the multiple pattern string matching problem, we want to find all the value shift for all the patterns inside our text. It could be the case that not all the patterns are present on the text, because if you reference genome is due to me, for instance, and we are trying to find all the text coming from your DNA, it could be the case that you have some differences with respect to my DNA. Well, for sure you have some difference with respect to my DNA. So there will be some small fragment of the DNA which couldn't be placed anywhere in my text. Okay. So the idea is to have to try to find all the possible occurrence of a specific pattern inside the test. And to do it, the best way to do it is to use a possible way to do it is to use a tree-based solution. So here we have a text and we have a tree representing all the subsequence of the tree. So for instance, the subsequence of, sorry, not the tree of the text. The subsequent the sequence subsequence of the text corresponding to the text itself is represented by this branch of the tree. So starting from this node, I can try to discover the position of the pattern cacao simply moving along this branch. So I'm here, since I want to match cacao, I read all the edges, all the labels of the edges moving from this character. My first character, matching character, is C, so I move here. Again, here I read A, so the next character would be here, and so on and so forth. Let's have an example. So at the moment, I haven't said how to build, of course, this tree, okay? So someone is asking whether this technique can be used to identify DNA. Well, I don't know what you mean by identify DNA. So let's say you want to you commit a crime, and you so someone commit a crime, for instance, kill someone else, and left some DNA traces on the environment. Well, in that case, you don't use this technique, because to distinguish DNA in legal cases, we usually use a technique involving, I think, seven different specific positions in the DNA. So there are, you can distinguish basically almost any human being, living human being, by using exclusively seven places in the DNA. You don't need to rebuild the overall sequence. Okay, so once you have tested that seven different places, seven different locations in the DNA are equivalent in the DNA you found in the DNA of myself, yeah, then you can conclude that DNA is mine. But you don't need to read the overall DNA. A different thing is if you want to understand the difference between the Cro-Magnon man and the modern man, okay? That in that case, for instance, you need to rebuild the overall sequence of Cro-Magnon man DNA. However, let me go back to the tree exam based solution. And so at the moment I haven't told you how to build this tree, of course, but as I said, this tree will represent the text we are dealing with. And let's try to search a specific pattern, the pattern cow. Okay, so how can we find the cow inside this tree? Well, we start from the root of the tree, which is this node. And by looking at the label of the edges moving from this node, which represent the empty string, we select this branch. So why this branch? Because the first character in the pattern we are trying to match is C. So from this node, I'm moving this in this position. Okay, here we are. Then the next character is A. And so here, luckily, we have exclusively one edge moving from this node, and the node is luckily labeled by A. So again, by reading a second character A, we can move along this branch on this direction and up in this position. Now, here we have two possibilities. Either the next character is C, and we move in this direction, or the next character is a no, and we move in this direction. Now, the next character is a no, so we move in this direction, and this is the end of the string. So this node will represent exactly this pattern, this substring of the original string inside the text. Okay? And the node is labeled with 3. And 3 is the position of the first occurrence of this pattern inside the test. 1, 2, 3. So by browsing this tree, simply by reading the pattern, we were able to discover first occurrence of this pattern inside the test. Nice. So once we have built this tree, what's the complexity of discovering the pattern? Of discovering the occurrence of this occurrence of the pattern inside the text? Well, the complexity is the complexity of reading the pattern itself. So the complexity is the length of P. Okay? Of course, we need to spend time to build this tree. But this tree is built once for all. You don't need to build it for every different pattern. So once you have built this tree once, you can use for any subsequent pattern matching inside it. For instance, if I try to search the substring AC, for instance, which is a substring of T, and we will discover it. Let's move, let's try to do it. We start from the root, which is the root of the tree, which is representing the substring, the epsilon substring. We move to this node because we saw that this arrow is this edge is labeled by A, which is the first character in the pattern P1, then the next character C. So we move in this direction, and that's all. So now we discover the first occurrence of this pattern inside the text is in position 2. 1, 2, AC. Okay? What if the if by applying this this procedure we end up in a situation in which we cannot move to the node we are searching for? That in that case the pattern is not present in the text. Okay? So now again, searching for pi in the text cost theta of length of pi. So once I have computed the tree, solving our problem takes time. Theta of the sum of all the sum of all the length of all the pattern, which is much better than the previous case. Okay, in the previous case, we are dealing with a complexity which depends on the text. And at each iteration of a search, we are spending a time which is proportional to the length of the text. Since here we are dealing with a text which account billions of characters, of course, this is quite expensive. This was quite expensive. In this case, we every search, every pattern matching does not depend anymore on the text. And this is due to the fact that the complexity related to the text is totally discharged on the way in which we build the tree. So in the process of building the tree itself. So how much cost building the tree? So let me first of all give a formal definition of something which is related to the tree we saw before, and then let's try to understand what's the cost of performing of building that tree from the text. And to do it, of course, I need to introduce some notation. We have so sigma of T is the set of all the substrings of T. So by substrings, I mean a pattern which occur in T, of course. So a suffix try T is a tree built in this way. We have for a tuple consisting in five values, sorry. First of all, we have Q, which is the set of the node corresponding to a substring in T. So each substring in T has a node, corresponding node, okay? Moreover, we have one more node which does not belong to Q. And you will see why is needed this node. I mean, the next lesson probably. Well, for sure. Then we have a labeling function, which is the function which tells us for each substring the shift of that substring in the text. Okay, so once I know that in my text there is AC, the substring AC, I want to know its first occurrence in the text. I mean, You can change it in the all the occurrences, but I don't. We will see how to do it the next lesson. Okay. So at the very beginning, let's assume that we have exclusively the first occurrence of a pattern, so a substring inside the text. Then we have the transition function, which is the function where, well, which is the the edges we saw in the previous example. So the edges would bring you from a node to another node, and which are labeled by using characters. Okay, so if I'm a substring X and I read the character A, I end up in a node corresponding to the substring XA. Okay, and this holds for all the substrings XA in T. This transition function, which is the set, basically the set of the edges and the corresponding labels on the tree, also has a strange thing, which is related, let's say, with the node we saw before, which is not belonging to the set of node representing the substring in T, saying that this node can reach the empty string, let's say, then the node corresponding to empty string for by crossing all by consuming, let's say, all the character in sigma. Okay, and finally f is what is called prefix function. The prefix function is basically a function which let you go from a substring to the suffix of that substring, actually. So if you are dealing with the node AX, by using the prefix function, you end up in X. And of course, if you are dealing with the node epsilon, by using this function, you end up in bottom, which is the node we discussed before. So now let's try to have an example just to understand what's going on. At the beginning, we are dealing with the text CA, and this is the suffix title corresponding to that text. So we have the root, so the string corresponding to the epsilon substring. As you see here, from one I can go to from this node, which is the root, I can go to this node by reading a C, and of course from this node I can go to this node by reading a, and from this node I can go to this node by reading a again. So all the substrings in my text have been represented: the epsilon substrings, the substrings containing exclusively an I, a substrings containing exclusively a C, and the substrings containing CA. Okay? So the black arrow represent the transition function. The red arrows represent instead the prefix function, which tell us how to move from a suffix to substring to a proper suffix, to the largest proper suffix of it. So from CA, I can move to A, so I consume the first character of CA by crossing this edge, which is the prefix function. And again, by A, I can go to epsilon simply by consuming this the first character. From A I can go to epsilon, the epsilon string, simply by consuming the first character, so A, and this is done by crossing this edge. And again, by definition, by epsilon I can go to bottom simply by crossing this edge. Okay, now how can we extend this suffix try and deal with the string cac, for instance? Okay, so this suffix try is the try representing ca, ca, and let's assume we want to to extend it by and deal with the string CAC. So how can we did it? Can we do it? Well, let's take into account, let's consider the node representing the overall text CA in the suffix try of CA. So that node is this one. Okay, since we are adding one more character to the text, of course we need to add an outgoing edge reaching another node which represents the overall text CAC. So the first step to do is to consider this node, which is the node representing the overall text of CA. Okay, and then add a new node and connecting the two nodes by using an edge, so a transition function, which is labeled by C. Why? Because we are adding the character C. Okay? Then what? Then by crossing the prefix function, we end up in the largest proper prefix of CA, which is A, and again we may need to, since we are adding C, to add a new character, sorry, a new node and connect that new node with this node by using an edge whose label is C. Here we are. Oh, please notice, since the label of this node was 1, the label of the new node is 1. Since the label of this node is 2, the label of this node is 2. Okay? Because the shift is the same, of course. And then what? And then we can again apply, find the largest proper prefix of A. Sorry, the largest proper suffix of A by crossing the prefix function. And oh, okay, we are missing two. Of course, since we added this new node, we can add the suffix function here, the prefix function here between these two, of course. And then we can cross again the suffix function, finding the largest suffix of this node, which is the empty string. And again, try to repeat what we did until now. So here we need to add, we may need to add a new node and connect the new node with this one by using an edge labeled by C. But actually, we already have a node here labeled by C. Sorry, we already have an outgoing edge labeled by C, which is this one. So we don't need to do anything more. Okay, apart from adding the suffix, the prefix function here. So the idea is start from the largest, from the node representing the largest sequence in the tree, represented in the tree. Keep moving along, so adding new nodes and keep moving along the prefix function until you end up in a situation in which you already have added the node you need. Okay? And that's all. In this way, we were able to update, in some sense, the original suffix try from the text CA to the text CAC. Okay? Now, let me give some names to what we did until now. So, the sequence we follow from this node to this node to this node and so on so forward is called boundary path. So the boundary path at this sequence starting from the largest prefix in the tree Yes, right. So someone is asking whether the black arrow represented the direction in the exploration of the tree and the red arrow represent the red function, the prefix function, and this is the case. Okay? So the red arrows are simply used to update the tree, let's say, while the black arrows are used to perform the pattern matching to solve the pattern matching problem. Okay? Now, as I was saying, the boundary path is the sequence of state you reach starting from the longest starting from the longest subsequent represented by the try up to a certain moment to bottom. So keep applying the prefix function. Eventually you end up of course in the bottom node, okay? So another important thing to remember is the active point is the first value in this boundary path that is a leaf. Okay? And this value, of course, corresponds to, so this node, of course, corresponds to the largest string represented by the tree up to a third point of its building. While the endpoint is the first node in the boundary path having a transition from the character we are trying to insert into our text. So we are moving in a situation from which we try to build up the suffix try of a text from the scratch. And to do it, we keep inserting new character inside the try. Okay? At some point we will deal with the prefix of length I of t. And this prefix correspond to this try, okay? And this try has a boundary path something like this. And since we want to add a new character in the text, the new character we want to add in the text would be I plus one, the I plus one character in the text. So the endpoint will be the point in which we already have an outgoing transition from the nodes in the boundary path labeled by the character we want to add. Okay, so how the algorithm to build from the scratch the suffix tree works. So the idea is to add, start from the active point and try and keep adding new transition, ti plus one transition, up to the end point. Okay? And that's all, basically. So this is the code, and that's all. Now let's try to understand the complexity of building a try. Of course, the complexity of building, since at each operation, each operation is performed up to the point in which we end up in the end point. So we start from the active point, we keep adding new nodes until we end up in a situation in which we already have a node reachable by a ti plus one transition. So all this perform step by our algorithm is meant to add a new node in the try. So the overall cost of the try of building a try is of course the linear with respect to the number of node in the try itself. Now, since all the substrings in T are represented in the try as a node, The cost of building a try for a text is basically theta in the number of substrings of t. Okay? Now, how many substrings can have a text? Well, the number of substrings for a text can be up to square of the length of the text itself. So if I take, for instance, the string a n times and b n times, I end up in discover the number of strings of this text is quadratic with respect to the length of the text itself. So, because of this, building a suffix try by using this technique cost big O of the length of t square. Okay? So, building the try as we already did, basically by keeping adding one more character to the try per time, per iteration, let's say, as a cost which is quadratic with respect to the length of the test. But this is not due to the procedure itself. So the procedure is optimal, meaning that it takes time which is linear with respect to the size of the graph of the tech, sorry, of the try. But this is due to the fact that the number of nodes in the try itself are quadratic with respect to the length of the text we want to deal with. So this could be enough if you are not dealing with huge text. But if you are dealing with genome-sized text, this is really unacceptable, of course. So we need to figure out a way to decrease the cost of the try, and to do it, the cost of building the try, of course, and to do it, of course, we need to decrease the size of the try itself. So how can we do it? Let's try to consider this try. This is the try of the text CAC, the suffix try of the text CAC, and this is really redundant, and the motivation to be redundant for it is that basically there are so many nodes, useless nodes. Once I've read C here, I'm forced to read AC. There's no other way to reach this node. Okay? So these two nodes, in some sense, are useless. And the same holds for this one. Okay? So a possible way to reduce the number of nodes in the try is to remove all the non-branching nodes which are not leaves. Okay, and to do it, we may try to basically update the transition function and the prefix function by to deal with a kind of virtual nodes. So instead of representing the overall nodes in the suffix try, we want to represent exclusively branching and leaves, branching nodes and leaves. And all the other nodes will be represented in symbolically, meaning we will use the non-symbolical nodes plus a kind of address of the nodes that we are not leaving. For instance, to deal with this node, we will say, instead of pointing to this node, we will say, look, I want to deal with the node reachable from this node and by reading C and A. Okay? So the idea is that in some sense I want to dismiss all the non-branching nodes by using a kind of address to talk about them. And this will be done by suffix 3 during the next and last lesson of this course. So I hope you enjoyed this lesson. It was really problematic because I had a problem with my computer, so sorry if you weren't able to follow everything. As usual, you may try, you find everything on Moodle and below this video. Let me know what's going on, if you understand, if everything is clear. As usual, I recommend you to have a look at the homework and the exercise. And try to plan a talk, a private talk or a global talk with me to try to solve all your problem on understanding the topic in this course. And for today it's all. So we will see the last part of this topic on the last lesson on Tuesday. So, thank you for the attention, and see you on Thursday then. Bye.